Have you ever wondered why the Blue Angels and Thunderbirds don't fly the latest and greatest fifth generation fighters? They have some of the best pilots in their respective services, and their whole mission is to showcase the power and precision of the American military. So why are they still stuck in fourth generation fighters? Let's talk about it. So, when we're talking about fifth generation fighters in the US arsenal, we're really talking about the F-22 and the F-35. Let's start by talking about the F-22, because it's a little more straightforward. First of all, it was never navalized, so that means that the Blue Angels are never going to fly it. The Thunderbirds, in theory, could fly it, but there's a lot of reasons why they wouldn't, and it's mostly because it's a technological dead end. There are only 186 of them in active service, and we stopped making them in 2011. And you might think that's weird because it's such an amazing aircraft, but it was kind of a victim of bad timing. And this is maybe the subject of a much longer video down the road, but the long and the short of it is, it was designed at the end of the Cold War to fight the Soviet Union and to maintain air superiority over their fighters, and it did. It's unmatched still to this day. In order to do that, it was so complicated for its time and so difficult to maintain and difficult to build that when the Cold War ended, it was really hard to justify them continuing to make it. With the Soviet Union gone, there was nothing in the skies even close to being able to take it down. After 9/11, the US sort of switched tactics to fighting terrorism, and terrorist organizations like ISIS don't have air forces at all, much less anything that could hold a candle to an F-22. So it just became essentially unnecessary. Because there are so few of them, and the ones that they do have are needed in active service, the Thunderbirds currently have 12 F-16s, 6 for demonstrations, and an additional 6 for spares. They're not going to take 12 F-22s and use them for the Thunderbirds. It's just not going to happen. Even if they did, there was never a robust maintenance infrastructure built up around the F-22 because there weren't enough of them made. There weren't enough maintainers that were trained. There were not enough spare parts made, and now the assembly line's shut down. Beyond that, it's just not really necessarily a good air show demonstration team plane. There is a great F-22 single ship demo that goes to air shows and does awesome maneuvers using the thrust vectoring and has that cool pedal turn and all sorts of amazing stuff. But none of that stuff can really be done in formation. To fly it in close formation like the Thunderbirds do, you'd basically be making it fly like an F-16 anyway, so there's kind of no point. So let's talk about the F-35. The F-35 was part of the Joint Strike Fighter program, which was a program designed to replace a bunch of different aircraft across all the different services of the US military all at once. As such, there are three different models. The F-35A, which is the lightest weight, fastest version that is used by the Air Force. There's the F-35B, which is the short takeoff, vertical landing capable model in use by the Marine Corps. And there's the F-35C, which is the navalized version, which has larger wings and more robust landing gear and a tailhook for landing on a carrier. Well, the F-35, it could be used in these teams. It would kind of be like using a very expensive surgical scalpel to open an Amazon box. It's just kind of overkill. The focus of the fifth generation fighters was on things that are not really necessarily helpful in an air show. So things like stealth, not helpful in an air show. Sensor technology, connection with other aircraft. The F-35 can link up with other F-35s, other aircraft, and basically create a 3D map of the battlefield. But again, completely useless when it comes to an air show. And because it has all this great technology in it, it makes it very expensive. The latest estimate was that for the entire lifetime cost was going to be $2 trillion. That's with a T, trillion dollars. The per unit cost actually ends up being about $80 to $100 million per jet, depending on the model, which is 3 to 4 times higher than a comparable F-16 or F-18. And those are F-16s and F-18s that are new. The Thunderbirds and Blue Angels don't fly new jets, they fly old jets. So you're talking about an order of magnitude more expensive to procure an F-35 for these teams than what they're currently flying. It's also way more expensive to maintain the F-35 because it is so new and they're still working out all the kinks, and it's so complicated that the per hour cost to fly it is also a lot higher than a fourth generation fighter. I know I keep talking a lot about cost here, and you might say, it's the US military, we can spend $2 trillion on a fighter jet, like why are we worried about cost? And that, you know, fair. You also got to keep in mind that these teams are recruitment tools primarily. They're not being used on the front lines. It's in the best interest of these teams to keep their costs low, because if you ever have a situation where you're looking to cut costs, like if someone in Congress was looking at the defense budget, they might point to these teams and be like, why are we spending this money on assets that don't actually see combat? I don't agree with that. I think the teams have a very important value to the country and to the service. And you probably think the same way if you're watching this video, but you can see how compared to frontline fighters, they might be under more scrutiny than other aspects of the military. And also, you know, the most expensive, fanciest, newest gear should always go to the front lines. So keeping costs down is important. Another thing that the teams use to sort of justify their existence in those scenarios is to say that they can turn around and return to active duty within 72 hours. That's both the planes and the pilots. I did a whole video about this, which you can see up here somewhere, about why that's sort of true, sort of not true. But regardless of how true it actually is, they need to be able to say that they can do that. Because the F-35 is so complicated, once you make modifications to it to be used as an air show aircraft, it would be a lot harder to turn an F-35 back into a fleet asset. Now, I'm by no means an expert in stealth technology, for example, and not many people are. In fact, the F-35 stealth characteristics are mostly still classified. But I feel pretty confident in saying that once you paint a jet blue and gold and white and red for these air shows, getting it back into the radar absorbent material paint that is necessary for an F-35 to reduce its radar signature is probably going to be way harder and way more complicated than just painting an F-18 gray, I think. There are also other modifications that have been done to the F-16 and the F-18 to make them suitable for the Thunderbirds and Blue Angels missions that would have to be figured out from scratch for the F-35. Like, for example, the gun in the F-16 and the F-18 is removed and replaced with a smoke canister. In the Blue Angels case, I know they also add a spring to the stick to make precise formation inputs easier to do. They also install an inverted fuel pump so that the F-18 can fly inverted for longer. They also install special Blue Angels specific software onto the jets that allow them to override some of the fly-by-wire safety systems in the F-18 to allow them to do some of the maneuvers that they do in the show that a standard stock F-18 wouldn't allow you to do. I know the F-35's software is supposedly extremely advanced. You'd hope it is when it costs $2 trillion. And if you know anything about software development, you know creating any custom software is very complicated and expensive and time intensive. And that would be time taken away from the primary focus right now is getting these jets off the assembly line and into active duty. And to take time away from that to create a custom version of the software for the Blue Angels and Thunderbirds is a little silly. Frankly, there are also some weird idiosyncrasies with the F-35 that would make it not suitable for the Blue Angels and Thunderbirds mission. One is, you can ask Tom Cruise about this. One of the reasons why the F-18 was flown so extensively in Top Gun Maverick as opposed to the F-35 was there was no two-seat F-35. There are two-seat F-18s. And as much as Tom Cruise would like you to believe that he was flying an F-18 in Top Gun Maverick, he was not. They're not going to let Tom Cruise fly an F-18. And the teams use the two-seat variants of their aircraft pretty extensively for a variety of different purposes. The primary one being that they give media rides to people in the media, VIPs, and they call them hometown heroes, where they travel to a show site and give rides to people to showcase what these machines can do. Another thing they use them for is training. When they bring new pilots onto the team, they will often throw them in a two-seat aircraft and fly them in the formation so they can get acclimated to how close the teams fly together, the types of maneuvers they're going to be pulling, doing stuff without G-suits, that sort of thing in the case of the Blue Angels. So that would not be possible with the F-35 at all. There are no plans to ever make a two-seat version of the F-35. And perhaps the weirdest quirk of the F-35 that would have to be worked out is that there's actually no HUD in the cockpit. So the HUD is the heads-up display. It's the little glass window that the pilots look through to check things like their altitude and airspeed and heading, that sort of thing. The F-35 has a HUD, but it's actually projected inside the helmet that the pilot wears, which is super cool on the one hand, but kind of restrictive because these helmets are custom made for each pilot and they cost $400,000 per helmet. So these teams often bring on about 3 new pilots a year. So you're talking about every year spending $1.2 million on helmets. So we've gone through all the reasons why the F-35 probably doesn't make sense for these teams to fly right now, but What is the plan then? Luckily, we don't have to think about this for quite a while. The Thunderbirds fly the F-16, which is one of the most mass-produced fighter jets in history. There were over 4,600 of them made. They're still making them. There is a huge infrastructure for maintenance personnel, spare parts. In fact, the U.S. Air Force just announced that they're going to continue to fly the F-16 in active service alongside the F-35 until the late 2040s, if not into the 2050s. The Thunderbirds have been in the F-16 for 42 years, and I can't believe I just said that. I had to look it up to make sure. They started flying in 1982, so yeah. On the Blue Angels side, they actually just transitioned to the F-18 Super Hornet just 3 years ago in 2021. Before that, they were in the Legacy Hornet, which they flew for 34 years. And the only reason they stopped flying it was because they were out of them. There were no more Legacy Hornets available. The Navy was done flying them. The Marine Corps was still flying some, but they were holding onto them because they were waiting for the F-35 to come online, actually. The Blue Angels will fly these Super Hornets until the wings fall off, essentially. The Navy has no plans to stop flying the Super Hornet anytime soon. There will be a large pipeline of Super Hornet replacement parts and maintainers and a whole infrastructure built around this jet that'll last for a very, very long time. But eventually, we will come to a point where they just can't fly them anymore, and what do we do then? Well, hopefully by then that'll be 20, 30 years from now. Maybe the F-35 will have come down in cost by then. Maybe there'll be a new fighter on the horizon and the F-35 will be old hat, and they can take old F-35s that have seen enough combat duty and repurpose them. But then they'd still run into the weird quirks of the F-35 that we'd mentioned that make it maybe not suitable for air shows. So they might not use it. They might actually go back to trainer aircraft. Now, this sounds like a downgrade, and let's be real, it probably would be. We'd miss the sound and the power of the frontline fighters for sure. But every other Western country that has demonstration teams flies trainers. The British Red Arrows, the Canadian Snowbirds, the Italian Frecce Tricolore, they all fly training aircraft. And in the 1970s, the Blue Angels and Thunderbirds actually did this transition when they were flying the F-4 Phantom, which was a frontline fighter in Vietnam that was very expensive to maintain, used a lot of fuel, and was kind of unwieldy for air shows. They had a lot of maintenance issues, crashes, stuff like that. So they ended up switching, as part of the fuel shortage of the 1970s, to training aircraft, which were much more economical. The Thunderbirds switched to the T-38, which they used for about a decade. The Blue Angels switched to the A-4. While it was not originally designed as a trainer, it was being used as one at that time. The Air Force is currently procuring a new training jet called the T-7, which is supposed to come online in the next few years. Unlike other trainers in the past, this is actually more comparable to a current fourth gen fighter. It's got flight characteristics that are closer to the fourth gen. It's got an afterburning engine, so it might not be as much of a downgrade as going from the F-4 to the T-38 or A-4. That'll probably be what ends up happening. They'll probably switch to trainers in a couple decades. So there you have it. That's why the Blue Angels and Thunderbirds don't fly fifth gen fighters in their demonstration teams. If you enjoyed this video, please go down below, like the video, hit the subscribe button so you don't miss any future videos from this channel. I've been having an absolute blast making these, and it's largely been because of the reception I've been getting from all of you. I really appreciate it. I really appreciate the support. So thank you so much, and I'll catch you on the next one.